Let's now take a look at the binomial probability distribution. The learning objectives. What do we want to get out of this particular section? We want to be able to identify an experiment as being a binomial experiment or not. Does it fit the binomial? We want to compute probabilities associated with events of a binomial distribution. And well, we want to compute the mean, not computer. This is a typo. We'll just fix that right there. Pretend like that's not there. Compute the mean, variance, and standard deviation of a binomial random variable. Okay, the binomial distribution is actually our first named distribution. So far, we've looked at stuff and said, hey, something's skewed right, it's skewed left. Here's a distribution, probability distribution for playing the game of craps or rolling a dice or flipping a coin. This is actually our first named distribution, the binomial distribution. There will be several more named distributions that we will work with. Why are the probability distributions important? Why is it that so important that we actually work with probability distributions to begin with? Well, let me ask you this. If you flip a coin, what's the probability that you get ahead? Well, your first thought is probably assuming the coin is fair. That's kind of important. That's a fair coin. There's an assumption that you just made. It's a half. What's the probability it's a tail? That's also a half. Well, the only reason that you can tell me that is because you know the discrete probability distribution for flipping a coin. You know it. You may not think of it in those terms, but you know it. If you didn't know the distribution for flipping a coin, you could never give me those probabilities. So why are probability distributions important? They give us a way to calculate probabilities. No distribution, no probabilities. It's that simple. When we start rolling dice and did craps, the only way we can start actually answering questions about probabilities is because we had that distribution. Okay, let's take a look at some properties of a binomial distribution, of a binomial probability experiment. First of all, there are n repeated, independent, and identical trials. I'm just going to go through these kind of briefly, what the four things are, and then we'll take a look at in more depth to each one of them individually. There are only two possible outcomes for each trial, and we're going to label one of those outcomes as a success, the other a failure. The probability of a success remains constant for all trials. And the last is the random variable, whatever you happen to use for it, x, y, t, w, t, whatever. Whatever the random variable is. The random variable will record the number of successes in n trials. Okay, one by one, what does all this mean? There are n repeated, independent, and identical trials. We know n, we recognize little n, lowercase n, as our sample space. Or, not sample space, our sample size. Well, it's the same case here, but when we're talking about a binomial experiment, our sample size, we now refer to that as the number of trials. As a number of times we repeat this experiment. Now, it's repeated and independent. Independent means if you know what happens the first time, it doesn't really tell you what's going to happen the second time. Well, remember in the previous chapters, we talked about independence, probability of A given B, if A and B is independent, is just simply probability of A. It's the same idea here. If you know what happened in one trial, or you know one outcome, it doesn't tell you what the other outcome is going to be. That's the idea of independence. Now, we don't actually have to work out those probabilities to show it's independent when we're dealing with a binomial. Actually, each of these assumptions that I'm going to outline, we need to show that it's reasonably satisfied. We don't have to get too technical with them, just reasonably satisfied so that we can use the binomial. And the trials are identical. If I'm flipping a coin and I'm going to try to model it with the binomial, I'm going to flip the coin the same time or same way every time. If I'm shooting baskets, I'm standing at the free throw line and I'm just shooting baskets, well, I could model that with a binomial and I'm going to do the same thing every time. Every time I shoot is one trial and I'm not changing the conditions. I'm not shooting at the free throw line once, going back to the top of the key and shooting again. I'm going to stay at the free throw line. So the process is identical. There are only two possible outcomes for each trial, one of which is a success, the other is a failure. A success is the event I'm going to say we are looking for. It is not necessarily good. We think of a success as something that's good. Well, it's not. A success in this case, in this situation, is simply whatever it is that we're looking for to happen actually happens. If it didn't happen, something else happened, then we call that a failure. It may or may not be good. If we're looking at the time to death for, say, a certain type of cancer patient, when the person dies, the time from diagnosis to the death, the fact that they did die rather than survived, the death would be a success. That's not good. It's just what we're recording. Okay, so I want to make sure you're clear on that. Success is simply what we're looking for. It's not necessarily a good thing or a bad thing. The other is simply a failure. Okay, so only two possible outcomes. One I'm going to call a success, the other a failure. Now, there could be many outcomes. I could be doing like a taste test. Here's my cola, here's Pepsi, here's Coke, and here's Sam's Club or something. I don't know. I have four colas out there. Well, there's four different outcomes, right? Well, yeah, but I could set this up as, or look at it as, they picked my cola or one of the others. So if they pick my cola, that's a success. If they pick Pepsi or Coke or Sam's Club or whatever, if they pick any of those other ones, I'm going to call that a failure. So now I'm only looking at two things. A success, my soda. A failure, they picked one of the other brands. The probability of success remains constant for all trials. And really, we need to emphasize reasonably. Okay, it may or may not and truly remain constant every time. Technically and mathematically, if the probabilities change from event to event, it's not a binomial. You can't do it. But if the change is minor, or if it's reasonable to assume that the probability of each event stays the same, or the success stays the same each time you do it, then it's okay to model it with a binomial. Keep in mind, anytime we calculate probabilities, the mathematics is exact, the application is not. It's a matter of, is this a reasonable outcome? Is this a useful thing to do? Is this a useful thing to have? If you calculate the probability of some event happening is 0.0017, the one thing that you know is in real life that probability is wrong. It's just hopefully it's close enough that it's reasonable, it's useful to have. The random variable X records a number of successes in N trials. Again, if I'm looking for deaths, when a death occurs, it's a success. And I'm going to have maybe 27 people in the study, so N equals 27. And I'm looking for the number of deaths in the first 5 years out of the 27. So the number of deaths would be a success. So X, if that's my random variable, if I saw 8 deaths out of that 27, then X equals 8. It records the number of successes. Again, a success is simply what I'm looking for. It's not necessarily something that is good or bad. Now, the data types is nominal. The reason the data type is nominal because what do you have? You have a success or you have a failure. That's it. Those are labels. That's it. They're labels. You're recording successes and failures. Okay, so in this next section, let's go wrap up for our introduction into binomial. In the next section, we're going to actually take a look at some examples, justify why they fit the binomial, and then start calculating some probabilities.